Well, I can't tell you how excited I am to have Joni Eareckson Tada on the program today. Joni, it's been ages since we've seen each other.
Oh my goodness, it has, but how good to be with you and your listeners and followers. What a thrill.
Yeah, well, and especially since you just got out of the hospital after a couple bouts with pneumonia.
Yep. Earlier this year, 25 days in the hospital. Just recently, 16 days in the hospital. But hey, I'm sitting up.
Yeah.
And we're talking about the Lord Jesus.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking of the 10 million quadriplegics around the world who would give their eye teeth to have this opportunity to sit up in a wheelchair and talk about the Lord. So I'm honored, I'm privileged, and I'm humbled.
What a great outlook. Can you refresh those who have known for many years your story? Can you refresh our memory? And also, there may be, you know, we have a lot of young people out there who have not heard your story. And can you just summarize it out of the gate?
Real quickly, 56 years ago, I was a teenager and I went to the Chesapeake Bay on a fling with my sister and swam out to this raft anchored far offshore and didn't check the depth of the water, took a stupid dive into what I found out real quickly was very shallow water. And I don't know how many of your listeners know this story, but I've got to tell it because it so speaks of the gracious sovereignty of God. I was face down in the water. I was holding my breath. And I knew that my sister had her back turned to me. There was no way that she saw me take that dive. And I knew I was going to drown if something didn't happen. And at that instant, a crab bit my sister's toe. And she quickly whirled around in the water to scream to me to watch out for crabs. And of course, when she did, she saw my blonde hair floating on the surface of the water. And she came and pulled me up out of the depths just as I was taking in water and about to drown. And I look at the amazing sovereignty of God that he would move a tiny Chesapeake Bay blue crab to bite my sister's toe at just the instant somebody was in an emergency and needed help. And so I like to joke, I never eat crab salad sandwiches to stay without thanking God for those little critters.
That's right. I'll never look at a blue crab again the same way.
Well, God's sovereignty has led me many years, Michael, and that's why I'm so excited about White Horse Inn, Solo Media, everything you do, because you are helping people handle suffering in a way that is gracious and gives God the glory.
Thank you. You were an athlete, and so this was especially hard because you played so many different sports. You love the outdoors. This was not like this dive wasn't like you just were an indoors person, and then one day you went out and didn't know what you're doing. You were an athlete.
Oh yeah, I was the least likely candidate to enjoy life in a wheelchair. I mean, I thought God had the wrong person. Mind you, I was a Christian at the time, although a weak Christian and struggling with my future and what was God's plan. And I remember asking the Lord right before I graduated from high school, God, do something in my life to jerk it right side up because I'm being hypocritical. I'm mediocre. I'm wishy-washy. I'm taking your grace for granted. Help me, God, help me get closer to you. And then I had the accident 2 weeks later. And Michael, at first I thought, how could God take me so seriously, asking for a closer walk with him? And then I land in a wheelchair. But over the years of depression, there were wonderful Christian friends who knew their Bible well and who loved me with a passion.
You grew up in the Reformed Episcopal Church, right?
Right, the Reformed Episcopal Church. And
when I first met you, I was ordained in it. That was my first ordination, was in the Reformed Episcopal Church.
And I think I remember that.
Yeah, Bishop Cummins Church was your church.
It certainly was. And Michael, I didn't know a lot of the Bible at that time. I was relatively new in the Lord, a personal relationship, but boy, I knew the Book of Common Prayer. Mm. And so when I was depressed at 2 o'clock in the morning, I wanted to cry. And there was nobody around to wipe my tears. I couldn't push the call button. And so I would lie in bed and say, Almighty and most merciful Father, we do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, for preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for the inestimable love for the redemption of the world.
I mean, Jesus Christ.
Whatever I knew, the Te Deum, the Gloria Patri, I mean, I just quoted it to God because I just wanted to draw near to him, knowing that if I did, he would draw near to me.
Wow. What you must have gone through 1,000 emotions in a day with God through all of this. What do you say to people who would say, okay, you were a Christian, you were reading your Bible, you were studying it, you were learning it, you were a good person, and what good did it do you?
As you say that, I'm thinking of that passage in Jeremiah where God says to his people, I will do them good with all my heart and soul. And I ask the same question of God that you just asked me. How can this be good? But there was a wise friend who was as reformed as I was at that point, and he told me 10 little words, just 10 words that changed my life. God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves, Johnny. Can you hang on to that and trust that God will, in time, show you his goodness?
What a line.
Well, it's just 10 words, but...
Yeah. 10 wise words.
Wise words, aren't they? And you know, I begged God to heal me. I thought maybe that was his idea of good. I would read Psalm 84, no good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless, and how he works everything for good. And what one of you, if you ask your father for a fish, will be given a stone? I mean, we have a good father, and people kept saying that, but I couldn't see it until finally I became so empty of myself. And here's where the turn came. This is where the crux of the matter. This is where change began to happen. I became so empty that I just said, help me. Help me, God. I don't get it. I don't understand it. You don't seem good, but... where else have I to go? You are the one with the words of life. And so, Michael, I turned my anguish Godward rather than inward. Mm. I think Martin Luther talked about how you can so easily turn yourself in on yourself. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't do that. I had to, who else is going to help me but God? And bingo, that's when I began to sense a difference in my life. I sensed the nearness of God. I sensed the sweetness of my salvation. I sensed, oh my goodness, there is a plan. I don't know what it's going to be, but it's when I said with King David in the Psalms, I am poor and needy. Mm-hmm. And he's a king. How can he be poor and needy? But he had emptied himself of himself. And at that point, boy, blessed are those who come to the Lord in empty-handed spiritual poverty, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And so I just started boasting in my empty-handed spiritual poverty, and change occurred.
What kind of change?
I began to be grateful. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18, the same friend that shared with me, God permits what he hates to accomplish what he loves. He said, begin with this, Johnny. Begin small, begin simple. Here's one Bible verse. Try living on this. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God. And I said, stop. I don't believe that because I'm not thankful. I was enough of a hypocrite on my feet. I'm not thankful.
And tell me to be thankful is telling me to be thankful isn't necessarily helping.
No, it's not. But then he said, read the verse again. It doesn't say be thankful in everything. It says in everything, give thanks. Mm. There's a big difference between giving thanks and feeling thankful. He said, Johnny, trusting God has nothing to do with trustful emotions. So put away your box of Kleenex and grit your teeth and find things in your day for which you can give thanks. And that's where the change happened. It was small. It was giving thanks for the fact that my hospital bed was near a window. I gave thanks that, a year after laying in bed, I was now sitting in a wheelchair. I could wheel places. I gave thanks for my mom and dad. They're still supportive, and my friends are praying for me. I just started mouthing thanks. And finally, my heart caught up with my mouth, and God rewarded me with the emotion of thankfulness.
Wow.
That's where it started, I think, with that verse.
Faith shouldn't wait for the right emotion. Faith should just run out ahead of it and then let the emotion catch up.
Exactly. Hmm. Exactly.
What kinds of things do people without disabilities say, Christians, fellow Christians, that we should kind of probably rethink or not say that aren't helpful to people who are facing difficult circumstances?
Well, I've been in that situation many times when I meet people, I talk with people, and they don't want platitudes. They don't even want Bible verses. They, you know, I'm hurting. I'm hopeless. What do? I can't stand this suffering. I'm so weak. And there would have been a time, perhaps, when I would have said, well, memorize Romans 8:28 and trust that all things are going to work together for your good. And Psalm 62, verse 8, trust in God at all times. This is one of those hard times. You know, I could have probably said those kind of things, and they would have been good and right and true, really.
Mm-hmm.
But when people are hurting, they don't want you to slap truth on a counter as though you are in a blood clinic and you slap, you know, a pint of blood there and
say,
here, this will fix you. Drink this. Ingest it. You know, believe it. You'll feel better. And that's not going to do it. I think God wants us to hook up our spiritual veins to the people who are hurting and infuse within them the faith they lack, the strength they don't have. And so what I most often say to people who are struggling and can't put life together, I say, boast in that. Wake up tomorrow morning and feel absolutely decimated and know that that's your key to the entrance of the kingdom of God. I mean, I wake up. I still wake up in the morning after 56 years of paralysis. I say, I can't do this. Two bouts with pneumonia this year. I cannot do this. God, you're asking too much of me this time. Well, obviously, he doesn't think he is asking too much of me. And so, okay, God, I can't do this. I cannot. I have no resources. There is no strength in me. But I can do all things through you as you strengthen me. So show up. Big time. And so I guess I just come alongside people and confess my own weakness, because isn't that where we all should be, poor and needy in front of God? And to see our afflictions or our inconvenient, difficult circumstances as the sheepdog that snaps at our heels and drives us to the road to Calvary, where we might not otherwise want to go. We probably don't want to go down that road. We're not naturally inclined to go to a cross which asks us to die to ourselves. But the sheepdog of hard times and difficult situations drives us, doesn't it?
Yeah, you never wish anything like this on anybody. But what could outweigh the cross of Christ and being brought to that cross and having the hope of glory?
Yep. So friends listening, don't waste your suffering. Mm. I mean, I think it was what Dr. Piper who said that, but it's so true. Don't waste it. Don't abuse it. Don't. I mean, it is a precious gift, for it is given to you not only to believe in him, but to suffer for his sake. So it's a gift. So learn to boast in it and learn to see it as your sheepdog.
Your husband, Ken, is here.
Isn't he the best?
Yes. I mean, what, first of all, how tell the story, how you guys met.
Okay, real quickly. I was in church bored with a sermon. I won't even tell you who was preaching, but you know him well. Anyway, no. That's not the point. The point was I was sitting there and I'm thinking, okay, this sermon isn't grabbing me. So I just felt, well, it's Sunday morning. I need to do something honoring to God. So if I can't listen, I'm going to pray. So I'll pray for the back of that man's head over there. I don't know who he is. Don't know his name. Don't know if he's good looking or wearing a wedding ring, but I'm going to pray for him, which I did throughout the length of the sermon. And then after the benediction, I almost went up to him and, you know, guess what I did for you? But I thought that would look pushy. And then we happened to meet about maybe a month or so later. And the first thing I said to Ken Tada was, turn around and let me see the back of your head. And it was him. It was the same guy. I said, I prayed for you. And that sparked
an
interesting conversation. And
that's wild.
We married the next year, and we've been married 41 years. So he's a good guy.
Well, praise the Lord. That friendship and comfort and that love over all these years must have been and is a huge part of who you are.
Real quickly, when we were first married, I didn't know a lot about love. You know, I think I got married to get my needs met, you know? And after caregiving for me for a while, after about a year or so, Ken one night sat on the edge of the bed and put his hands on his knees, slump-shouldered, and said, I can't do this anymore. I am so tired. And Johnny, I feel trapped. Well, my response was, well, you think you are trapped. What do you think I am? I'm the one who's paralyzed in this wheelchair, not you. And it was awful what I was saying. But of course, you know, you spill out these words that you wish you could stuff back in your mouth as soon as you say them. And it pushed us to the edge in our marriage. And somewhere along the line, just like in my own life, coming to that place of empty-handed spiritual poverty, Ken and I knew we needed to draw near to God and help each other do that. So we started praying for each other. We started memorizing scripture. In fact, on the way over here, he's so funny. I start to recite my scriptures in the van that I know by heart. And before I get through the prelude to Ephesians 1, he's off reciting the entire book of Romans 12 and then James 1. And it's like, okay, when do I? You're such a competitor. But all this to say, it changed our hearts. It really did. It warmed our hearts to each other. Mm-hmm. The more we drew close to God, the individually, the closer we got to each other. Until one
day. So his suffering, too. Brought him to a closer
absolutely
walk with you, with the Lord.
Even though our marriage is difficult with this quadriplegia, he is very grateful because it has changed him as well. And there was one night, maybe 5, 6, 7 years later, where, again, repeat performance, Ken sits on the edge of the bed, and I had lost a couple of helpers who were assisting, so a lot was landing on his plate. And he said, I feel so trapped. But this time I said, sweetheart, I understand exactly how you feel. I don't blame you. I don't fault you. If I were you, I'd feel exactly the same way. Mm. But I'm going to pray for you, and somehow we're going to get through this. Mm. God has told us that he will never forsake us or abandon us. So I'm going to believe we're going to make it. I'm your best cheerleader, hon. And we'll do it. I promise I'll help you. What a difference from that snarky, snippy response, right?
Yep.
7 years earlier.
You went back to being the woman praying for the back of his head.
That's right. Exactly. Although I had grown and matured quite a lot since that.
I'm sure. You've done so much with Joni and Friends for people with disabilities. I could go down the list. We don't have time. Even working for the U.S. State Department's work on this, you've been a major champion, have contributed significantly to the profile of this need for the rest of society to recognize and make places for people with disabilities. Briefly, what is your latest project in that regard?
Oh, well, it's a life investment. Michael, I've been blessed so much. I mean, I'm sitting up in a wheelchair, like I said at the beginning of our time together. So many quadriplegics can't do that. They don't even have wheelchairs. And there have been some people who look at me and say, well, look how blessed you are. I mean, you got a husband, you got a job, you make an income, you go on vacations, you got, you know, insurance. And I say, I know I do. I'm blessed. I am privileged, but I'm not going to hold on to that. My goodness, I'm going to do everything I possibly can and squeeze every ounce of ministry out of my quadriplegic body to make it better for other people with disabilities. If God has given me generous gifts, I'm not going to hold on to them. I'm going to pass them on to the next person with a disability. And so we just finished delivering our 225,000th wheelchair overseas to needy children with disabilities. We hold retreats for families struggling with disabilities here in the States, and also 38 retreats in developing nations. We established Johnny's House, which are places where the gospel is given, and marital counseling for couples with disabilities. I mean, I could go on. And I just love pouring out my life. The more I'm blessed, the more onus is on me to pass on the blessing. I will not cash in my IRA and move to Florida and play pickleball. Mm-hmm. Can't pay to play it anyway. But never should.
And how many more years would you have anyway if you did?
Right.
And is that
right.
Really?
So is that what Christians should do? Forgive me. I don't mean to.
No. Yeah.
Sounds snarky.
All right. No. Right.
But we to the last day. Even Jesus, when he was dying on the cross, he was serving other people, his mother, the thief on the cross, the Roman soldiers. I mean, he was forgiving and loving and caring, and here he is dying. Mm-hmm. And so up to my last day in this wheelchair, Michael, I want to do all I can to make Jesus real to other people with disabilities.
Mm. Let me ask a question that is a little more on the ethical side of things. You know, people increasingly seem to be talking about the right to die, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. You've written a book, When Is It Right to Die? A Comforting and Surprising Look at Death and Dying. This is broader than the whole question of euthanasia, but just people feeling like they own their life. Sort of the same thing with abortion, right? I own my body and I own this, you know. What do you say to people who say, I decide. I have a right to die. I have a right to my own autonomy.
Well, first let me say Christians must never say that. You have been purchased with a price and a big price, and so honor God with your body. Your body is not your own. So Christians should never be asking, well, maybe I should abort this child because the amniocentesis shows that he has a profound disability. So, I mean, no. Christians should be the champions of safeguarding life. And, but if you don't know the Lord Jesus, for one thing, it is not the state's responsibility, should never be the state's responsibility to help you end your life when you may not have the psychological wherewithal to do it yourself. That's not the state's responsibility. You can look in our Constitution, our Bill of Rights. So my disability advocate friends and I are doing everything we can to prevent euthanasia laws, right to die laws, assisted suicide laws from spreading here in the United States. And I think we are gaining momentum because now we're beginning to see the terrible effects of liberalized assisted death laws in Canada, where now, even if you're depressed mm-hmm. or you get a diagnosis of multiple sclerosis, yet you're walking around and feeling great. I mean, you have the so-called right to die. We don't want that here in America. People with disabilities are, okay, give us special education, maybe special parking places, but not a special right to die. That's out of the state's purview.
And what kind of culture tells people with disabilities they should have a right to die?
Not a compassionate one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Compassion is not 3 grams of phenobarbital in your veins if you don't like the medical diagnosis you just received from your doctor. Compassion is having someone come up alongside your bed, pull you up out of social isolation, ascribe positive meaning to your pain, connect you with reality, create spaces where you feel like, once again, you can survive or thrive. That's what people did to me. I remember being on my hospital bed, violently shaking my head, my neck back and forth, hoping to break it up at a higher level. But as I shared earlier, I had Christian friends who came into the hospital and they did all that stuff to me. They ascribed positive meaning to my pain. They did not let me remain socially isolated. They created spaces for me to thrive and survive. And I'm so glad. So everything depends on Christians stepping into this arena, rolling up their sleeves and practicing a little bit of Christianity where the rubber meets the road of people's pain and disappointment about their condition. Give people reasons to find life worth living and introduce them to the resurrection and the life, the Prince of Life, He who has the words of life, you know, the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is all about life. And once you get to know Him, then those questions about assisted death fall by the wayside. Hmm.
Wisdom and winsomeness. I can see why Larry King had you on so many times.
Well, I love the chance to talk about my Savior. Mm. He's just the best. He's my best friend. I can't do life without Him. I have developed, it's not even a discipline. It's a way of breathing, you know, just finding Him everywhere and seeing Him in everything and appreciating. And like my friend, 1 Corinthians or 1 Thessalonians 5:18, finding reasons to be grateful and thankful. You'll never meet a more grateful person than me.
Well, Joni Eareckson Tada, we are grateful for having you on this program, and because, you know, this world is a more beautiful and kinder place because you're in it.
That's sweet of you to say, and Michael, I want to thank you again for Solo Media, White Horse Inn, all that you are doing. I cannot begin to underscore to our listeners how much the doctrine of God's sovereignty, developing biblical literacy, understanding the great doctrines, sanctification, justification, heaven, hell, sin. I mean, getting deep into God's word, not just wading in the ankle depths of it, but plunging out into the ocean and getting to know the richness of His word. You talk about that. You do that through Solo Media, and I'm so grateful.
Thank you so much.